Nation Alliance. In November 2014, he was one of many people arrested on Burgundy Mountain protesting against the proposed expansion of Kinder Morgan's Trans Mountain Pipeline. He stands with the elders and leadership of Treaty 8, opposing the Site C Dam initiative, and for many years has walked with the strong leadership and dedicated supporters of the February 14th Women's Memorial March. He is most recently in the news for refusing to take part in the Black Rod Ceremony with Prince William in Victoria in the provincial parliament in protest of the federal and provincial government's inaction on key First Nations concerns, including Enbridge, Kinder Morgan, and the Site C Dam. We are so lucky to have Grand Chief Stuart Phillip with us today in the aftermath of this incredible statement. So please join me in welcoming him.
Questions. intellectual. Now that I'm thinking about it, he was a real character. Issues that deal with the appalling levels of poverty that represent the everyday reality in our communities. The question was put to the chiefs of assembly based on the inability or unwillingness on both Canada and British Columbia to go beyond paying lip service to the need to reconcile these issues, whether it was appropriate for me as the president of the Union of BC Indian Chiefs to attend and participate in the so-called Black Rod Reconciliation Ceremony at Government House in Victoria. And the response from the chiefs was a resounding no. And at that point, I that we communicated with the organizers to let them know that, I would not be attending. It was a polite declining of their invitation, and we said clearly it's not a matter of disrespect, it's a matter of principle. And the last several days have been endless phone calls and interviews and public discourse on the royal tour and the reaction to myself not attending, what that represented. It's triggered a debate on social media. I'm also the chair, as I indicated earlier, of the Open Nation, and there was an event yesterday at the University of BC Okanagan. Initially, I was scheduled to do the opening, and of course, needed to be consistent, and I did not participate in that ceremony. So all of the out there didn't come on the phone call to reporters. We've been getting calls from the United Kingdom, from CNN,
good,
New York,
yes,
from all over the country. And in regard not only to these issues, but the recent announcement last night that, a bit of a background on who we are as individuals and what our organization is about. We welcome any questions. We're briefed for a national inquiry, and needless to say, under the Harper government, there was a national refusal to entertain that idea. In fact, then Prime Minister Harper said that, quite frankly, this is not high on our radar. But we now have achieved a national inquiry. There was a pre-consultation period where women's groups and indigenous peoples were asked what they thought, how the inquiry should be organized, and how it should be managed, and so on and so forth. And with that, I'm going to ask Andrea to
The coalition that the people spoke up earlier has quite a lot of people on it at this point, and it was started in response to the OPAL inquiry, this Women's Commission inquiry a few years ago. A number of groups and organizations that were shut out of the inquiry, and by that I mean they didn't receive, including the CIC, didn't receive funding to participate, and given the extensive amounts of legal documentation that we needed to go through in order to go to the inquiry, they literally were not able to participate. So a number of the groups came together to make a statement on that, and then continue to meet afterwards to seek justice for Indigenous women and girls. And the coalition's grown quite a bit. We have a lot of family members that are also part of it that really guide the work, and we have a lot of Indigenous women leaders that have been involved, as Stuart Phillip was saying, and advocate for bringing the attention to the issue and bringing the national inquiry for decades. And UBCIC has supported the call and the lead by these groups.
different backgrounds with respect to different positions on site work, different life experiences, people that have been directly impacted by colonialism, residential schools, writing poverty, things like that. And it's quite a network at this point. The coalition's been very clear that the issue has always been championed and led directly by largely indigenous women, and it's a very open group to having been involved as well, and there's been the recognition that even though it's been led by indigenous women, they still want to have men there to hear and to act as allies and to listen to what's happening and listen to the very high level of discussion that's happening and kind of take that back and bring messages in other areas and everything. And the meetings can be quite raw because of different experiences that people bring to it. And sometimes we're dealing with the ramifications of women who have literally had their children murdered and are dealing with receiving information from police that wasn't available from maybe 9 years ago, things like that. So it's a very fresh and intense issue, and we are involved with the national inquiry. It's going to be interesting to see how it plays out. I think everyone's got a lot of optimism still about it. It's going to be interesting to see how we can incorporate all the feedback from the women and the groups and the family members as it moves forward, and trying to avoid the pitfalls of having, of course, it has to be a very crowded process because it's a very large process. But how can we, of course, still meet the needs of the women and families is what the coalition is working on right now.
And it takes enormous volumes of water that they have taken out of the Peace River. And I've been up in Treaty 8 territory on just countless occasions, and I've seen B trains going down the highway every quarter of a mile. It's a real sight to see the big drill sites and so on and so forth. So the LNG facility in the Pacific Northwest, great surprise that misused, it's misconstrued. It's become a word of political convenience for both the government of Canada and the province of British Columbia. It comes on the heels of the bringing forward the report of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, which has brought forward Langara recommendations from the governments and the doors. So it's the pleasure of the month, pleasure of the day. And so all governments are paying lip service to the need for new forward reconciliation, reconciling the present and the past so that we can chart a path forward into the future. And to date, both the Trudeau and Park governments have paid lip service to the need and intent to move in that direction, but have not followed through. On the one hand, the Trudeau government has made much of embracing without preservation the UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous People. We went to New York before the UN and made those grandiose statements. But in terms of actually implementing it, they're not moving in any decisive fashion. Many of you probably know that only Saganash has developed a private members bill that is very well considered to have thought out. This legislation would actually feature a reasonable way to implement the Declaration of the Rights of Indigenous Peoples. However, the federal government has flat out rejected.
Reconciliation in this country and this province, you're going to need to change the legislation, you're going to need to change the policies, you're going to need to change how funding is distributed. For example, in education, post-secondary education, secondary education, both on and off reserve, there needs to be a concerted effort across the country to bring those graduation rates up. You know, it's an investment in our youth, it's an investment in our future. This government, the Christie government and the Trudeau government, they make time for meetings and they definitely make time for photo ops. What they don't make time for is actually sitting down and doing work. They would rather meet and talk about the small little incremental steps that they're taking and hail those as victories than rather sit down and talk about policy. That's what's going to happen. There's some leadership that talk about reopening the constitutional debate and the Constitution itself to truly reflect that this is not a country that's founded on two nations. That is something that was prior to the past,